You're watching Reality Check. As part of a global news collective, NDTV has gained access to internal documents of Facebook. Documents which bring out how the social media giant struggled in containing hate in India. A day ago, we reported on how Facebook was aware of the explosion of inflammatory comment, especially targeting Muslims around key events like elections, the anti-CAA protests, or even the COVID pandemic. Now, this seems paradoxical given that India has been a key market for Facebook with around 50 crore users. India is the largest in terms of Facebook's users. And Facebook has gone to great lengths to get onto the good books of the present government. The head of the Facebook in India was one of the first few top officials of big tech companies to back the Modi government's controversial new IT rules, criticized by others. Yet the Facebook papers reviewed by NDTV finds that RSS and BJP linked groups and users who are connected to this government are a big contributor to this hate wave, one which Facebook itself admits it struggled to contain because of both inadequate resources and political sensitivities. My colleague Mariam Alvi joins me. She's been doing a deep dive into the Facebook papers. Mariam, what is it that you found?
So yes, Vasu, so NDTV as part of a news organization's consortium has reviewed a Facebook document from earlier this year, which shows that pro-BJP and RSS groups, users and pages are some of the largest contributors to hate, particularly anti-Muslim hate in India. This is of course worrying, but more worryingly, it raises some very serious questions. One, is Facebook admitting that they had inadequate means to contain hate? Two, was political sensitivities behind FB's struggle to contain hate, especially RSS-linked hate in India? So now let's get into this one by one. First of all, what is this document? What does it say? This is a 2021 Facebook internal document that was reviewed by NDTV called Adversarial Harmful Networks India Case Study. It lists the RSS, the ideological heart of the Sangh Parivar, in a slide titled Groups and Pages Replete with Inflammatory and Misleading Anti-Muslim Content. RSS users and groups, they say, promote fear-mongering, promote anti-Muslim narratives. These narratives sometimes include calls to oust the Muslim populations from India. They also speak of a number of dehumanizing posts comparing Muslims to pigs and dogs. And it's not just the RSS. They also say that pro-BJP pages also contain such problematic content. They speak of a high volume of content linked to the love jihad narrative, which is linked to obvious Islamophobic content as well. They also say that many pro-BJP and RSS entities suggest that Muslims spit on their food to either make it halal or to spread COVID-19. This is, again, they say it's part of a larger hashtag boycott halal campaign that is popular in many states in India, including West Bengal and Kerala. They also speak of how there are posts that suggest that Muslims are using halal food as an economic jihad. Mm-hmm. They also point out that the use of the word jihad is a fear tactic. Now, while this spate of hate is, of course, worrying, what is of even more concern is that Facebook seems to be struggling to contain it. In the same document, which is just from this year, 2021, they say that our lack of Hindi and Bengali classifiers means that much of this hateful content is never flagged or actioned. Now, remember, this is from 2021, right after the 2019 Lok Sabha elections, the 2020 Delhi elections, both of which saw highly divisive rhetorics, sometimes echoed on social media. Mm. At this very crucial time, what this document seems to be admitting is that Facebook did not have Hindi and Bengali language classifiers to identify and take action against hateful content. More worryingly, they go on to say that we have yet to designate this group, the RSS, given political sensitivities. Mm. This again raising the question of whether Facebook has done enough to combat hate in India and whether political reasons are behind Facebook's apparent inability to control hate in India.
Right. And Mariam, you've also been looking at these papers and you reported this as well, mm-hmm. where you also found that despite the fact that there's been a high prevalence of hate in India, Facebook officials have sought to downplay it.
Yes, Vasu, so this is a January 2019 document titled Critical Countries Review with Chris Cox. Chris Cox is a top executive of Facebook. He was in charge of the Facebook apps, including Instagram, Facebook, WhatsApp, etc. at the time. He had said that there is comparatively low prevalence of problem content on Facebook. Surveys tell us that people generally feel safe in India. Experts tell us that the country is stable, almost downplaying the prevalence of hate and hateful content in the country. But interestingly, within 2 years, by 2021, other documents that we had reviewed showed that Facebook had changed their tunes a little bit, so to say. They had said that India had been now assessed as severe for societal violence.
Right. So you have a Facebook official who almost seems to be in denial in the face of so much evidence of rising hate. And it's just important to remind our viewers, Mariam, that these are, again, Facebook papers that are documents that are part of disclosures that have been made to the American SEC, right? The Securities and Exchange Commission, which have been provided by Frances Haugen, who's the whistleblower. Her counsel has provided redacted versions of this to the SEC, and these are those very documents. Now, you've been reaching out to Facebook about their response. What has that been?
So a spokesperson for Meta, the rebranded version of Facebook, told us that they don't allow hate speech on Facebook. They remove it when they find it or are made aware of it. They said they're investing heavily in people and technology to help find and remove hateful content quickly. They say, we know our enforcement is not perfect, but regular transparency reports show we are making progress. On questions on the lack of Indian language classifiers, they said they have had hate speech classifiers in Hindi since 2018 and Bengali since 2020. They have since added classifiers for violence and incitement in Hindi in early 2021.
All right, okay. So Facebook continuing to push back against these allegations. Thanks very much indeed, Mariam, for joining us. Okay, let me go across now to Sophie Zhang, who is a Facebook insider, who, like Frances Haugen, is one of those who now come out of Facebook and have been criticizing it. And Sophie Zhang, let me ask you this, because the point is that every time Facebook is asked these questions in the face of testimonies of people like yourself or these internal documents, they keep coming out to say there's no problem. Hate speech is a barely 0.0 or less than 1% available on our platform. How do you respond to this?
I think that this fundamentally isn't surprising, because Facebook is a company that whose goal is to make money. Tobacco companies denied for a long time that cigarettes were addictive or gave people cancer and tried their best to avoid admitting it. I understand that Dow Chemical, formerly Union Carbide, has still refused to take the responsibility for the chemical disaster in Bhopal. So unfortunately, this I don't think Facebook's behavior is surprising, because at the end of the day, if Facebook will not fix the world, and that's people step in to force it to do so.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So in your own experience, what exactly happened when people like yourself were trying to raise some of these questions? What kind of response did you get from your own leadership?
So in my specific case, it was an unusual situation, because when I raised things to high up leadership, they were very reluctant to actually say no because of the terrible optics of doing so, I would presume. And so it was usually more that I would not get a response. For instance, with my work on India, which you have, I was never told, no, we can't take down these fake accounts that were associated with the BJP MP. No one ever said that, because no one ever gave any answer. And my personal guess is that that was because they could not allow themselves to be put in the position of saying no to that, because it would look so absolutely terrible for them. At the same time, it's also true that in early January of 2020, I was ordered to stop all of my work in this area, including in India, on the rationale that it was not important to the company and not valuable to Facebook. And so I eventually argued for continuing some of my work on the rationale that I needed to be responsible and finish tasks that I had already created and not mm-hmm. leave them incomplete. And that was the justification I used to justify my continuing to work in India to protect the Delhi elections from a network of fake accounts that were acting to inauthentically support the app in the Delhi elections. But if Facebook had gotten their way, I would not have done that in the first place, because that was not assigned to anyone.
Right.
And ultimately, Facebook is a company. Its goal is to make money. We don't expect tobacco companies to solve cigarette addiction. We don't expect Dow Chemical to repay the people of Bhopal out of the goodness of their hearts. And Facebook will say a lot of nice flowery things, but fundamentally, they are no different.
Okay. Just like Facebook is pushing back, the other stakeholder which doesn't seem to be really getting engaged in all this is the Indian government. You've been coming out many times to say that you're willing to share this information with the Indian government. Have you been approached by now by the Indian government?
It's on public record that Dr. Shashi Saroor, I believe, the head of the Standing Committee on IT, has asked the Speaker of the Lok Sabha for permission for myself and Francis to testify. I believe he stated that on Twitter. I will say that I have been in communication with him. I don't want to be specific more than that, just because I don't think it's my place I don't think it's my place to speak openly about my communications with the Indian government. Except I have offered them to testify. I have offered them my documentation. If you want more specifics, I suggest you ask them directly.
Well, we do try to ask, but one doesn't always get a response.
Yes, I'm trying. Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm trying my best to be respectful of everyone involved, and usually the people expect these sorts of governmental proceedings to not be shared with the press.
All right. Okay. Thanks very much indeed, Sophie Zhang, for joining us. Let's go across to panel. We have with us Rohan Gupta.
Much.
Thank you. We have Rohan Gupta, Chairman, Social Media Department, and spokesperson of the Congress. Alok Watts, leader of the BJP. Jawar Sarkar is with the Trinamool, but let me start with him because he's also been former CEO of Prasar Bharati. Jawar Sarkar, I believe you're also on the Parliament panel for IT. Is that correct? Have I got that right?
Yeah. Yes, that's correct.
So what do you make of this? The fact that there is so much coming out about Facebook's practices, or some would say malpractices in India when it comes particularly to checking hate and all of that. And yet, it doesn't appear that the Indian government or even the parliamentary panel, I mean, Sophie Zhang did mention Shashi Tharoor, but is actively reaching out to these whistleblowers or these documents that are coming out to understand, you know, what's happening.
First of all, let me clarify that the Standing Committee on IT and other allied subjects is not a part of the Indian government. It is part of the governance of India, but certainly not part of the Indian government.
Oh, absolutely, yes.
It is profoundly influenced by the Indian government in a blunt sense, that more than almost half the members of the committee are people who support the ruling party.
Right.
And a small more than half, and then there's a fraction that goes in for proxy support, which means that the majority is with the government, of the members. That notwithstanding, the committee tries to fulfill its duty by eliciting information. The task of the committee, and I have gone through the past papers because I've just joined, and I have gone through the past papers to see that the last time they called a social media giant, the BJP almost staged a walkout, saying you can't call. Now, the question is, I know what's going on. It's blow hot, blow cold. Blow hot, blow cold. While Modi goes and embraces, hugs all foreigners anyway. He goes and hugs Zuckerberg and put in for the, what shall I say, optics.
Right.
And they have this Ankhi Das here openly parading her opinion in favor of the government.
Okay.
At the same time, there are elements within these organizations that have, still have a conscience and report.
Right.
And these they try to browbeat. These, I mean, so it's blow hot and blow cold.
Okay, all right. Alok Vats, blow hot, blow cold, because if you look at what the documents are telling you, that multiple instances where these documents point out that the hate is being driven on Facebook by BJP RSS linked groups that are actively spreading anti-Muslim hate.
Well, I agree with this, that there has been hate speeches, misinformation, fake news and inflammatory contents blowing hot and cold on the Facebook. But I don't agree with this, that this is solely being done by people who belong to the BJP and RSS. See, there are very many bad elements working to break the social fabric of India, and they are more active than the others.
But I'm saying that as someone who's a supporter of the BJP, five or three or six wrongs don't make any one right. Why are BJP and RSS linked groups spreading so much terrible anti-Muslim hate on social media? And it's now all coming out. This is not the opposition saying it. This is not the, you can say, oh, this is biased media. These are Facebook's own internal documents which are saying that. Why is this being done?
So why did they not control it? Why didn't they not stop it?
Hand in glove with it? That's a question for Facebook to answer. But as a supporter of the BJP, how would you justify the fact that groups linked to the BJP and RSS are spreading terrible hate?
This is where I say this is a wrong misinformation.
What do you mean?
There are people trying to point fingers at RSS and BJP supporters. There can be some little bit of, people doing this. But the majority of the people are not in this game. We are in the game of building a strong India. We are in the game of building a social fabric where Hindu and Muslim stay together.
Okay.
But then there are some bad elements who are
Okay, this is what Facebook's documents are saying. They're not saying this is a small phenomenon. High volume of dehumanizing posts comparing Muslims to pigs and dogs, suggesting that Muslims spit on their food to make it halal, accusing them of economic jihad, claiming that they are taking over the country through population. They're seeing a massive, a high volume of this. And it's coming from, according to them, BJP and RSS groups, supporters, users.
You see, all this is what has been said from the beginning, that RSS and BJP supporters are saying all these things. But some of these things that you have spelled out is true, that Muslims do some such of things.
What? What do you mean? What are you talking about?
I mean, people selling fruits, they have been rubbing it.
Oh my gosh. No. Sorry. We cannot have, we're talking about bigotry and we're talking about misinformation. We can't have that on the show. I mean, what does that mean? That Muslims are, I'll come back to you. They're just completely unacceptable. Rohan Gupta, let me ask you this. The fact is that bad actors, political bad actors, across the board, I mean, Congress may want to take the moral high ground on this, but these documents have also found that there's misinformation coming from a host of actors, political actors, including the Congress.
See, Srinivas, it's not about Congress or BJP. We are a very sensitive country, and the platform which has 37 crore users in the country, it is their responsibility to ensure that the platform is not misused. And if you see the reports which are coming out, intentional.
One second.
Right. Let me complete.
Rohan Gupta, one second. We can't go on. I'm saying we have to be accountable also to ourselves. It's like saying that you're Absolutely. Driving badly on the road and then you blame that, you know, you blame the person who made the road or the traffic, or you have to take it's your problem. So political shouldn't the Congress, specifically on the Congress, shouldn't you also curb the tendency to do disinformation, to push out fake news?
You tell me one instance, Srinivas, I am the head of Congress social media, that we are spreading the misinformation. It's not our business. And at the end of the day, we are a sensitive, politically sensitive country. You tell me who is going to benefit out of what is happening with Facebook. At the end of the day, last 2 years, we have been raising these issues.
No, you
that
may
Facebook
not, you
is
may,
becoming
you,
the...
You may, I mean, I will certainly next time come with instances of Congress misinformation, but I'm sure
Absolutely.
Even if you don't do it directly, no, but there are ways of doing it through surrogates, through proxies. Surely, you know how that works.
Absolutely, we don't believe in that, Srinivas. That is the difference okay. between us and BJP. There are 100 examples I can give. You give me one example, I'm there to discuss on that. See, my okay. point is different, Srinivas. Facebook is not a local company. It's a global company. They have global standards. And for last 2 years, if these reports are coming, the platform is misused by for the fake news or hatred. It cannot happen like
okay,
that.
Okay, let me get a last word in from Alok Watts. Alok Watts, why is the government not proactively calling these whistleblowers and understanding from them what is happening? Is it because the fear is that what they're telling you is actually embarrassing for the ruling party?
No, but Sophia Jang just clarified that she is in touch with the government. She didn't want to divulge what is the dialogue going on with them.
She's saying that she's in touch. She said that Shashi Tharoor has contacted her, but it's not at all clear that the government has contacted her.
She also held herself back, saying that I will not disclose the content, but she meant that she is in touch with other people also in the government.
So the government has called her?
I'm not sure about that, but
okay.
The way she said, it seems that she is in touch with the government and there are some contents she doesn't want to divulge.
Okay, I literally just for 20 seconds, last word from Jawahar Sarkar. Jawahar Sarkar, you think realistically there will be an attempt to call these people to understand exactly what's been going on with Facebook in India by the government?
We would like, a large section of the committee would like to call them. It depends on the rules, depends on whether the rest of the committee members are willing.
Okay.
I would propose that we call them. But the point is that this is, you have to understand that misuse of social media is an integral part of the campaign on which Modi has come. So there's no point of asking him to go vegetarian now. You see, this has been going on for a long time. There's no question of proxies. Amit Malviya himself heads the most poisonous group of social media messages.
All right. We're out of time. But by the way, again, all parties, I mean, I would say even Trinamool, everyone has got into this game of fake bots and handles and disinformation. So let's hope there is greater responsibility as we head into another election cycle. But we're out of time. Thank you all so much for joining me on Reality Check. Thank you so much for watching. Good night.